We'll turn to page 393, when we all get to heaven, page 393. That's what I need, paper clips. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Mercy and His grace in the mansion, high and blessed, when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus shout victory. While we walk a pilgrim pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sigh. Get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. Let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of Him in glory will the course of life.
Evening. So just take your time. The reason I called you is you're so quick. I knew you could get up here quick. Yeah. There he is. There he is.
Cat-like reflexes of that young man right there.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for the opportunity to be in your house tonight. Thank you just for the message that you gave us this morning and for keeping us safe until we came back here tonight.
Lord.
God, we ask you now just to open our minds, open our ears. You hear the message that you have for us tonight. God, allow us to bring it to the world, allow us to change others, and allow us to be a light and a beacon that just points to your feet. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Kyle.
Thank you. Be seated. Let's see. Let's get a couple of ushers together if we can. Take our offering for our faith promise. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. There we go. That's why I called Brother Kyle up here. He's got them cat-like reflexes. You know, somebody else would blew out a hip if they tried to do that. But anyway, including yours truly. But let's remember quite a few people tonight in prayer. I know that we have quite a few things going on this week. And we had some folks that Brother Chad Chu, his family, I guess they'll be heading down to Fayetteville with the death of his grandfather. I know there's some other procedures. I know Brother Bob asked for prayer for Miss Margaret. She's got a procedure tomorrow, is it? Wednesday this week. So let's remember that. And we want to go to the floor real quick, take some prayer requests, just anything mentioned tonight that want to set maybe on your heart that's maybe coming up this week. Anybody have anything? Of course, let's remember Brother Billy Kennedy. He's still in the rehab area getting recycled there so he can get out. And, you know, he's been in there for a little bit over a week now, I think. So let's remember him. If anybody else have anything,
remember Brother Eric Smith. Don't forget about him.
All right.
Motorcycle accident. They did move him to High Point, Wake Forest High Point. So he's in the rehab there.
Yeah.
Remember Brother John's mother, Vera Conley. I know she's got something going on, and then she's got to take some treatment. She's got E. coli. Her, they got to get that cleared up. And then there was the rest. Her. Don't forget Sister Robin's dad at the hospital. I know some of these we tried to meet this morning, and I appreciate Brother Terry working tonight. It's been good to see my friend Brother Anthony Kimmer with tonight. Him and his wife. He's a newlywed. How long have you been married, Brother? 3 years. My gracious me. And so I want to pray for him. He's a good man. Met him with Brother Daniel Cannon, so don't blame that on him. But Brother Daniel, pray for all the service, the revivals that Brother Daniel, Brother Ralph, these other men are in. We certainly appreciate it. Yep.
Everyone back in.
Brother Bud back there.
Yeah, you can't miss a hand. It right. might touch the light there. Go ahead, Brother Bud. All right. Appreciate that, Brother Bud. It's Judy. Okay, remember that.
Sister Betty's mom, Louise D. What a joy it was to meet her the other day. She told us that she watched the services. They're way better, Brother Terry. So
and as I told you, Michelle's father passed away in Dallas. We'll be going down at the end of the month for the funeral there. I think I told you that in Sunday school. So I've been praying for you. Go ahead, brother. Okay. Anybody else have anything they want to make mention tonight?
Got enough to know to make something.
What you got, huh? No fights broke out. Couple close times there. Back to reality. That's her always when we come off vacation. Back to reality. I said, well, I never left reality myself, but she lives for floating. Like a Cheerio, yeah. Anyway, anybody else have anything tonight?
My mother.
Right. Mildred and Terry Thatcher.
Yeah. We all know how that. Remember Jim and Margaret Honeycutt too? They're doing really good. Jim touched base with us. He did some preaching.
Amen. All hearts clear, unspoken. Are you having something else, Miss Judy? Okay. Thank you for that. All hearts clear, unspoken. Brother Ronnie, won't you show me your cat-like reflector? Come on up.
Yeah. About 8 lives left. About shot them all up.
Dear Lord, we ask you to bless each one of these prayers.
Yes, God.
Be with the families. Lord, we're so thankful for this church and each one in here. And oh, God, we're so proud to be a part of you.
Yes, Father.
And Lord, just guide us and protect us. We ask this in your holy name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Brother
going upstairs or somewhere there's air conditioning. Well, go with Brother Chris there. We'll dismiss the youth this time. Go ahead and dismiss the musicians. And
hey, glory.
Jeez, somebody got mad. Anyway, all right. Preacher, come on.
I always think that's a lightning strike for some reason when you got all that going on. And, you know, I just appreciate the good spirit of the Lord. I appreciate this. A horse there. And I said, no, it's not a little horse. It might be a pony, but it's not a little horse. And Brother Denny didn't even laugh at that. Isn't that something? But I appreciate my friend, Brother Anthony, being here. He's a new friend, and we're thankful for him. And after we fellowship with Brother Daniel, one of the reasons I appreciate Brother Anthony is he's a local businessman, and you know, God's and touched his heart. He's a Christian. He's just recently married. And so, you know, me and him, we had a good bonding experience there in Longhorn, and he bought my dinner. Amen. Isn't that wonderful? So, you know, just it's always good to have friends like that that want to buy. Amen. And so I appreciate all that he does, his testimony, and his new wife, Sister Remy. Is that right? Remy. Okay. And she's from the Philippines, and doesn't look like that she wasn't able to be with him tonight. But two shall become one. She's with you, brother. I promise you, two shall become one. And they, these other newlywed couples in here, I tell you, we got at least two or three, and I'm excited for them. You know, all the things that they're going to learn and relearn. Amen. Amen. I tell you, it's just wonderful. And so let's get over here in John 16. I was looking at this a little bit earlier in the week, and, you know, when you start talking about the Holy Ghost, when you start talking about what God has sent us, or who God has sent us, rather, it's really interesting to understand when you open the Bible, you are opening your eyes to the Word of God, you're opening your spiritual eye to the Word of God, and what we need to understand is it's just as if Jesus is sitting in front of us. And wouldn't it be amazing tonight if you could look into his eyes? You ever thought about that? I mean, we get Holy Ghost goosebumps physically. I get goosebumps just thinking about looking into his eyes. Because he is God in the flesh. He has filled us, those of us that are saved, born again, with his Holy Spirit, who is just as powerful as God the Father and God the Son. We have God in us if we've accepted by faith, through the grace of God, what he has done for us in Christ on the cross. If you believe that, then Jesus is talking to you tonight. I love it. Now, I don't have time to read 14, 15, and 16, but we can hit some of the high points in John 14. Of course, we all know verses 1 through 6. Every funeral, every person that, you know, maybe is going through a difficulty or a stressful time, we know Jesus said, let not your heart be troubled. Now, that's easy for him to say, right? It is. He's God. I don't know that there was ever a time that his heart was troubled unless when he died on the cross for you. When he saw how far we had fallen from the original idea of worshiping God, how Satan and the devil and, you know, this old flesh and the world and the curse that had been handed down, we don't always understand. It broke his heart when he saw he came to his own and his own received him not. I mean, that would be like your mama and daddy, you know, not acknowledging who you are. It hurts. But thank God, you know what Jesus said? He said, when your mother and father cast you out, I will take you in. So it does happen. But I'm glad God said, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. He's my spiritual father. And one day he's going to be my eternal father. Somebody ought to say amen right there, because I mean, he's going to meet every need. And what a wedding that's going to be when we're there in the bridegroom. I mean, and listen, me and Brother LJ are going to be flawless. Say amen, Brother LJ. Me and Brother Anthony, I mean, we'll all have full heads of flowing hair. Yes. We'll all have everything and we'll be perfect. What a day that's going to be. Ladies, there'll be no crow's feet in heaven. Isn't that wonderful? All right. John 14, I love this. Look at verse 15. If you love me, keep my commandments. And I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another. Notice the words now. Notice the verbiage. If you've never looked at it, God just didn't run out of spaces here and say, you know, I think I'll put a word here. Another comforter. He's the comforter, Jesus. But he said, I'm going to give you another comforter. One just like me. And that's who the Holy Ghost is. He is the comforter. He's just like Jesus. He's God. He's just like the Father, just same power, excuse me, same power as the Father, not just like the Father, but he is the same power as the Father. That he may abide with you forever. You know, when I think about those things, about how God, the Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost give us comfort, I think about when I was little and the storms would really bother me. And I would run to my dad. I do. I thought it, you know, if I can just get to him, I'll be okay. And I knew that I was going to be okay. That's the idea. That's the type that I see right there. Do you realize who God gave you tonight in the Holy Ghost? A comforter. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him. We did not know the Holy Ghost until Jesus introduced us to the Holy Ghost in his word. Now, you may have experienced something, but you didn't realize what or who it was until the Holy Ghost knocked on your door, your heart's door, and said, hey, it's me. I'm the one Jesus told you. How do you know it's the one that Jesus told you about, preacher? Well, he said, I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you yet a little while, and the world seeth me no more, but ye see him, because I live, ye shall live also. Now, you got to remember, Jesus is talking to his disciples. They didn't fully understand who he was talking about. Just the same way some of us may tonight not even realize who it is that's speaking to our heart, if you're a child of God. So, at that day, you shall know that I am in my Father, and ye in me, and I in you. Boy, there's a Trinity. They say the Trinity's not in the Bible. Well, they need to get them another Bible. They need to read this Bible. Trinity's in the Bible. He that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me, and he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father. Boy, there's the Trinity again. And I will love him and will manifest my... How is he going to manifest... How is he going to reveal himself to us? Jump on down. Let's go on down here. Verse 25, these things have I spoken unto you, being yet present with you. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, Trinity, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I have said unto you. Now, if you go on and you read there, he talks about his peace. He's talking about a relationship through the Holy Ghost with his disciples. You get on over and you jump on over into 15, and he's talking about fruit bearing, Brother Terry. He's talking about gardening. He's talking about how God is the great gardener, and the vine and the branches and all these other. And you have fruit, more fruit, much fruit. He's talking to his disciples about it. Spiritual blessings. What he's talking about. And in verse 16, I believe it is, let me see, 15, henceforth I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth, but I have called you friends, for all things that I have heard of my Father have I made known unto you. You have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you that you should go forth and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatsoever you ask of the Father in my name, he may give it to you. These things I command you, that you love one another. Oh my. I told him in a funeral yesterday, I said, everybody close your eyes. So everybody close your eyes. And I said, now, when God speaks to you, when God sees you, when God sees people, this is what he sees. He doesn't see skin. He doesn't see gender. He sees souls. That's how God sees you, through the blood of Christ. No wonder we should love one another. No wonder we should get our eyes off each other and get our eyes on Him. No wonder we should realize that the flesh is not saved and that God doesn't save skin. He saves souls. Yes, He does. Why don't we see people like God sees them? Love one another. I mean, such were some of you before God saved you. And you're to thank God He saved you. Verse 18 says, if the world hates you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. Wow. Okay, I got to get over here. I'm not even in chapter 16 yet. So, those three chapters right there on the Holy Ghost. I'm telling you, man, that is some good stuff. And then Acts 1, 2, 3, we know, we understand that. A lot of people think that Matthew is a transitional book. But really, when you start talking about the transition of how God used the Holy Ghost in the Old Testament, bled over into the New Testament, and then you've got the church, Acts is really the transitional book for all the church to be filled with the Holy Ghost and for God to show us how the church should operate and be administered on the day of Pentecost. The Bible's an amazing book. It's a history book, but not a lot of people know how to study. I'm loving. Hey, we started that Christ in the Old Testament on Wednesday night. Boy, I am loving that. I can't even give you what I got yet. It's not Wednesday night. Think about turning the live stream off on Wednesday night so you have to be here. I'm praying about it. But I know that people are shut in sometimes, and some people are just locked in to the live stream, you know. I'd rather be here with y'all. I'd rather be here. You know, Brother Tyler's asking us to do a online book of Romans, and that's going to be new to me. I know we did the upper room and all that, but this is something totally different. So you pray for me. There's a lot of other things going on there, and so just pray for me. Pray for the school. Pray for Brother Tyler. And pray for all that, the decisions that are going to be made there, okay? So, all right, let's get over here. John 16, are you there? All right, let's stand real quick. Want to honor God's word. I'm going to read the first verse, and then I'm going to ask Brother Kimmer, if he would, just lead us in prayer, okay? Bible says, these things have I spoken unto you that ye should not be offended. Brother Kimmer, pray for us. Yes, Jesus. Oh, God. Please, Jesus. Amen. Thank you. You can be seated. So, when you've got these little excerpts, these little passages here of Jesus talking to his disciples, okay? Disciples is one that's disciplined in following the Lord Jesus. That's where we get that word. And so, Brother Darrell, let's go. I know that we got it up here, but I just want you to look at, you know, these are some images, some portrayals, if you will, of, you know, the Jesus talking with his disciples and different times that he had talked with his disciples. This image here shows, you know, after the resurrection, we know that that hadn't taken place yet. That hadn't occurred yet. Brother Darrell, go to the next one. And you'll see, you know, Jesus over different periods of his ministry would talk to his disciples. And you know, wouldn't you just have loved? I mean, now that you're saved, born again, got the Holy Ghost, wouldn't you just love for that to have taken place in your life? I mean, to just sense the honey dripping from his mouth and his beard and just the wisdom that God can give you sitting right in front of you. I mean, it's amazing. We have it. We have it. He said, these things have I spoken unto you that ye should not be offended. And I mean, Jesus speaks of the conflict that's coming from the world. He does. He mentions that in 14 and 15 and now here in 16. He says, I'm talking to you. And I hope you'll understand me because there's trouble coming. there's conflict coming in the world. Now, it's like he just read the headline in the newspaper today. It's like we just looked on the internet or we watched some of our news channels or something. We know there's conflict. Man, there's conflict in the world. There's a lot of it. So Jesus speaks of that. He tells us about it. He warns us. He says, heed it, because it's coming. So why don't we listen to them that are in the world? Last time I checked, reality, we are in the world. But we're not of the world. That's where the conflict is. Amen. Because you're not of this world. You're a disciple of the Lord. You're following Him. You're Spirit-filled. And so there's a review that He's given us here of this persecution. Look at the second verse. They shall put you out of the synagogues. Yea, the time cometh that whosoever killeth you will think that he doeth God service. What? Oh, yeah. Well, that is so good. That water is so good. He said there's going to become a day when people are going to start killing Christians and disciples of mine and thinking they're doing God a favor. How about that? Oh, that's happened before. It's going to happen again. And they will say that they're doing God's service. Who's God? Not our God. You know, God has all power. Our God has all power. And if God allows that to happen, that was going to happen. But, you know, when you start looking at the review of this kind of persecution, we don't know anything about that in America. We don't know anything about, well, preacher, I'm a Christian. Jesus said, hey, that things are going to go on in the world. You need to be in this book right here. You better get in this book right here, and you better understand that Jesus said, I love you, and I love you enough to tell you the truth, and I'm going to give you a heads up, and I'm going to put the Holy Ghost inside of you to give you comfort that when the conflict, not if it comes, but when it comes, you'll be able to deal with that. It may happen tomorrow. It may happen tomorrow. We don't understand. So he gives us this review here. He said, you're going to be put out of the synagogue. You're going to be kicked out of the church. You're going to be kicked out of the fellowship. You're not going to be able to go to church. You're going to have to run. You're going to be put out physically. Wow. You know, I talked to some of the local sheriffs around here, and they're doing some things for schools and businesses. And I said, what about churches? And I had one of those sheriffs say, you know what? You're right. What about churches? Churches are essential. And the light went on. So, hey, we may sign up first. I'm not afraid. Hey, this is God's house. I mean, your babies go here. Your friends go here. Your family members are here. We should be safe here. This is where we come to feel safe. This is where our refuge is, our oasis. And I'm not going to have to worry about the devil, the flesh, and the world getting in here. I don't worry anyway. It's God's house. And so he says here that they're going to be killed. That's what he says. They're going to be killed. He's giving you a review. He's giving you a heads up on the persecution. He says that you're going to be looked at as enemies of God. But you're not. You're his disciples. Oh my. I mean, how twisted and how tainted the devil and the world looks at Christians. I bet you thought it was going to be rose petals and dandelions and butterscotch and, you know, banana pudding and all that, you know, right? No, not in this world. But in God's kingdom, yes. God's kingdom to come. So your faith is in Christ. Your faith is in the King. You can't have a king without a kingdom. Praise God. So the review of this persecution, Jesus says, I love you enough to tell you the truth. I love you enough to give you not only a review, but a reason for the persecution. Brother Darrell, is there another picture? Okay, so that's more realistic there. He's talking to his disciples. You don't have to turn it again, brother, because I think that's all we put up there. I just wanted to give people an image to understand. Which one are you? What if you could hear Jesus? Oh, man, I just felt a little sprig right there. What if you could just hear him? What if you could see him physically talk to you? I mean, really, the reason for the persecution is because of your love for him. You ever thought about that? Look at verse 3. And these things will they do unto you because they have not known the Father nor me. But these things have I told you, that when the time shall come, ye may remember that I told you of them. And these things I said unto you at the beginning, because I was with you. He said, the reason I'm sending you the Holy Ghost is because I'm not with you physically right now. Well, I'm loving this. I need this right here. I mean, I'm raising two teenagers, and God help me. I've already given those teenagers to God, and they're getting ready to start back to school tomorrow, and, you know, all these things, they're growing up. You got to understand, Jesus said, I'm trying to tell you something. Ooh, I'm listening, Lord. I mean, I'll be honest with you. I've been through some things here, you know, last 3 years, and I wish I'd listened a little closer. I wish I'd have heeded some things a little more. But how do you know he's not talking to you tonight? If you're a disciple, he's talking to all of us. He said, I'm trying to tell you something because there's going to come a time when I'm not going to be with you, and I want you to understand the truth, and I want you to remember when I told you this. 14:26 said, he'll bring all things to your remembrance. And I'm going to tell you something. Over the last 3 years, God has just really had verses just jump off the page. Oh, to me. Especially that, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me, he said. He said, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. Brother Darrell, we said that yesterday, and we were sitting up there, and I could see Brother Darrell was helping me yesterday, and I could see people looking around in the sanctuary and in funerals and, you know, in the fellowship, and they're saying, you know, what's he talking about? In my heart, I'm saying, get on them, Jesus. Let them know that our lives are but a vapor. Let them know that don't look for tomorrow because you're not promised it. You got to deal with it right now. And I pray that God dealt with them through the power of the Holy Ghost. And so our persecutors do not love the Father. They do not know Jesus. They do not love Jesus. The people that are the enemy, the persecutors of Christians, they don't know the Father or the Son. And so when they sense the Holy Ghost in you, they're going to hate you too. Jesus said that. He's given us a review. He's given us the reasons why they do not love the Father nor the Son. The reason they're persecuting you is because they don't love the Father or the Son. Well, there's the Trinity again. Trinity's all in the Bible, y'all. Don't listen to the devil. He's a liar. Flesh will lie to you too, and the world hates you. So, we need to understand that Jesus speaks of the conflict that will come to them from the world. And next, Jesus speaks of the Counselor, the Comforter, the Holy Ghost, that will come to them from the Father. He's talking to us tonight. So, what's the prerequisite? Look at verse 5. But now I go my way to him that sent me. And none of you asketh me, whither goest thou? Because I have said these things unto you, sorrow hath filled your heart. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. Look at this phrase. Look at this phrase. Boy, I'm telling you. God's touching my heart tonight, y'all. You need to pray for me. He said, I tell you the truth. It is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him unto you. Well, that's rich. He's not with us tonight. He's seated at the right hand of the Father interceding for us. But guess what? The Holy Ghost is in you. Yes. Amen. Yes. Praise God. He's wonderful. He's true. Well, preacher, there's naysayers, and they say, oh, where's the promise of? Hey, just shut up. I'm listening to the Lord. Hey, the Holy Ghost is in me. Amen. I mean, well, preacher, that's kind of offensive to be telling people to shut up. Well, I can't hear the Holy Ghost if you're yapping in my ear. Praise God. He's inside me. I'm trying to focus. It's like Matthew, he's just like his daddy. I'm telling you, he is. Now, Michaela, she can pick up on stuff. She can do all this other stuff, and she's registering. And I have to really focus on what I'm listening to. And even Matthew, bless his heart, he struggles like his daddy does. Like when Michaela's old 16, she's working, she's Dario doing all this other stuff. And y'all know what I'm going to say. Y'all know exactly what I'm going to say, because I said, Matthew, now when you get 16, you're going to go to work? You're going to get you a job? Absolutely. Wait, what? What? What, Daddy? I'm sorry. I'm trying to focus on it. He's going to be a professional gamer. Yeah, boy, that's good. He's not got there yet, but, you know, he's going to understand one day. And I am so thankful for that Bible camp. I'm so thankful for Brother Chris and, you know, Brother Michael and everybody that went, all the adults that went on that, because, you know, what you don't understand is I believe that's why sometimes the devil attacks us, because we do something good. We have victory for God, and we are used as a vessel. And this devil, the flesh, and the world don't like that. So we do need to pray for Brother Michael. We do need to pray for our babies. Brother Eric had a big victory. His kids come back on fire for God. He told me, called me, and saying all this stuff, and him and his son hit the altar that morning. Somebody say amen to me right here now. Then he has a motorcycle accident. But he's shouting. He said, preacher, I need to be closer. He said, I hear you say it all the time. I need to be closer to God tonight than I've ever been in my life. Hey, that could have went another way. And then, you know, what we've been through, and still can say, God, I love you. I want to be close to you. I need to be close to you. That's a real thing. That can only take place through the Holy Ghost. The only way you can be close to God is to be filled with the Holy Ghost. Think about it. You can read all the Bible you want. You can get in a rocket ship and try to go out into the universe. The only way you can be close to God is to be filled with the Holy Ghost. It's a real thing. He's a real thing. He's a real person. So he gives us this. Jesus says, unless he goes away, the Holy Spirit will not come. Now, they didn't understand that. No, Lord, we want you close to us. We want to stay close to you. Jesus said, you don't understand. You don't understand. The Holy Ghost is coming. I got to go away so the Holy Ghost can do his work. Jesus said, I've already finished my course. Hey, I'll never get over what he put under the blood of Jesus. I'll never get over what Jesus did for me. But he said, if I don't go away, the Holy Ghost won't come. You know, the disciples just said, well, then go on. But they love him. And you know, let me tell you something. Did you know after Jesus had risen from the dead, he stayed on earth 40 days? He loves his bride. He didn't want to leave. He had to go. You ought to think about that a minute. You ought to study that out. 40 days. 500 plus saw him after he had risen. 500 people recorded testimony that he was alive. So what's that purpose? What's the purpose for all this and this, the discussions and, you know, the way he's speaking to his disciples and the way he's just expounding and giving review and reasons for all these different things that are going on and the prerequisite? Well, here's the purpose. He will come. The reason the Holy Ghost is come. Watch this now. First of all, just jump over there. We're going to stop in verse 7. All right, look at verse 8. And when he has come, he will reprove the world of sin. And of righteousness. And of judgment. Of sin because they believe not on me. Woo. Talk about sin. Those that don't believe on Jesus. I mean, listen, they're in their sin. He said there, you know, he said, it's not that you believe on me. It's because you don't believe in me that you're going to hell, that you'll answer for sin. He said, if you believe on me, you won't be condemned. But if you believe not, you're condemned already. That's what he's saying. That's exactly what he's already told his disciples. Of sin because they believe not on me. Of righteousness because I go to my Father and you see me no more. He is our, I don't want to get too much. He is our example, folks. That's why he sent the Holy Ghost to us to convict sinners and to convince us that he is the Son of God. He went away. Well, we know he died on the cross. No, look, he went away after he was resurrected. He rose from the dead and then went away. Mount of Olives. I stood there. Got some rocks from that place. I stood there. Stood in a little temple that they built up there. And man, what a place that is to go and know that Jesus ascended back to heaven from the Mount of Olives while they watched him go. I've stood on that hill. I stood at Calvary. And one day I'm going to stand with him. Preacher, that's wonderful. That is so good, preacher. I am so glad. I am so glad. Somebody took my picture. Your wife took my picture holding this lamb this morning. That's me looking at the Lord. Them big old eyes. Isn't that beautiful? Thank you, sis. Appreciate that. Do you see yourself tonight? I mean, we're physically in this sanctuary. We are walking on this earth, but spiritually, we're in another, hey, listen, we're in another world, y'all. We're in Christ. One day I'm going to be with Christ. Praise God. What a day that's going to be, brother. Brother Anthony's probably not going to come back anymore. He's just said, he's crazy. He's lost his mind. It's not the first time somebody said that. I love it when God begins to tug on my heart. Yes, I love it when there's a tug from another place. You know, we're on the little end of something huge. Oh, man, what a day it's going to be. Oh, my. So he sent the Holy Ghost to convict sinners. Let's go to verse 11. Of judgment because the prince of this world is judged. He sent the Holy Ghost to condemn Satan. To convict sinners and to condemn Satan. Verse 12. I have yet many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them now. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth, for he shall speak of himself. But whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. So not only did he come to convict sinners and to condemn Satan, but he come to counsel the saints. You're going to be okay. You're in Christ and Christ is in you. You're going to be okay. I'm counseling you. He's the counselor. He's the comforter. Think about who the Holy Ghost is and why he came. Because Jesus went away. And why he's here. Think about it. It's amazing when you look at the Word of God and how God has laid this out to us to show us and review and to show us the purpose and to give us the reason for all these things that are happening. I'm on the winning side, praise God. Amen. I fear no man. Now, listen, I'm not talking about being egotistical and, you know, all that, but, I mean, listen, you imagine Brother Daniel up here filled with the Holy Ghost and you come up here and put your hands on that man. Are you kidding me? I wouldn't. He fears no. That's God's man. And you're God's child. Are you listening? Do you understand? And the reason that I believe the reason I call him a man of God is because he's matured now. He is so mature in that word, and God has got his hand on him, and he's a prayer warrior. He's a man of God. Yes, he is. And there are women of God. I wouldn't put my hand on him either. And I fought some tough women in my life, I promise you. But I wouldn't put my hand on a person filled with the Holy Ghost. Are you kidding me? Lay not thy hand against God's anointed. I don't fear anybody. You think I fear Joe Biden? Now, some of you are, boy, he's off his rocker. I'm talking about, yeah, he might be. I don't know. You're talking about me, though, right? I don't fear any man. I don't fear flesh and blood. It's a spiritual warfare we're in tonight. It's evil versus good and things of God. That's what we're attacking against. Why else do you think he sent you the Holy Ghost? To be filled with the Holy Ghost, to protect you and to keep you, counsel you, convict you. Amen. Because I got a champion for a Savior. Hallelujah. Man, he's never lost a battle. Praise God. He's in you. Look at verse 16. Well, let me clear my eyes here. 14. He shall glorify me, for he shall receive of mine, and shall show it unto you all things that the Father hath are mine. Therefore said I unto you, he that shall take of mine and show it unto you a little while, and ye shall not see me, and again a little while, and ye shall see me, because I go to the Father. He's coming back. I've got a champion for a Savior. That's why he sent the Holy Ghost. Convict sinners, condemn Satan, counsel the saints, and to champion our Savior. How about that? That's why he sent him. So, you know, we all got this. We all understand this. I mean, oh, preacher, it's registering with me, so we understand. But then, watch this. Don't forget who he's talking to, y'all. He's talking to his disciples. And, you know, they're probably sitting there going, looking at him going, what are you talking about? But God's not the author of confusion. The disciples didn't understand what he was saying. You want to know why? They hadn't received the Holy Ghost yet. We have the Holy Ghost. We have the Holy Spirit. Amen. I mean, you get over here and it says, then some of his disciples, look at verse 17. Then said some of his disciples among themselves. Notice they didn't say it out loud. Among themselves. What is this that he saith unto us? They didn't say it to him. He's God. He's powerful. He opened blinded eyes. He multiplied the loaves and the fishes. He's God. You got to understand. They were dealing with that among themselves. Well, a little while and ye shall not see me. Where's he going? And again, a little while and ye shall see me. What? Is he a magician? Hocus pocus? What is he talking about? Let's don't be so hard on them. Let's don't condemn the disciples yet. Because there may be somebody in here tonight doing that. What's he talking about? What's Jesus talking about? Because, and because I go to the Father? Notice they're talking to themselves. They're talking amongst themselves. They're not talking to him. They said, therefore, look at verse 18. What is this that he saith a little while? We cannot tell what he saith. What's he talking about? A little while and he's not going to be with us. And then a little while and he's coming back. We can't understand what he's saying. Now look at verse 19. I love the Lord. I love the Lord. They didn't say it to him, but look at this. Now Jesus knew that they were desirous to ask him. Jesus could tell that they were kind of perplexed. He knows your heart tonight. He does. Not to mention the fact that we might be going, what's he talking about? He knows your heart. The comforter's in you. The counselor's in you. Amen. Do ye inquire among yourselves that of that I said, a little while and you shall not see me, and again a little while and you shall see me. He knew what they were asking. He knew. He did. They didn't ask him. They knew. They didn't understand it. He knew they didn't understand it. And the God, listen, the prince of this world is the author of confusion. But I am so thankful that Jesus gives clarification. He gives the explanation in verse 19. A little while and ye shall not see me. Talking about his death. Hey, and then, which bringeth about grief. You know they're all going to be sad. You know that death always brings about grief. And then he says, and a little while and ye shall see me. Reference to his resurrection. He hadn't been there yet. They hadn't done that yet. Now we can look back and see that it happened. He's asking them to look ahead. And you know Peter couldn't handle that. Peter just soon cut you as you try to touch somebody he loved, right? He's talking to his disciples. He's preaching to them. He's trying to give them the warnings. He's trying to talk to you tonight. He's trying to tell you things are going to happen. He's trying to tell you, give you a review, give you a reason. He wants you to, he understands when you get confused, but he's going to give you clarification. He says, well, I can't wait till we get to the end of this. I got to hurry. He says, I'm your example. He hadn't been to the garden yet, Brother Terry. He hadn't sweat those great drops of blood under stress. He hadn't been beaten yet. They hadn't plucked out his beard. They hadn't opened his back up with a cat of nine tails for you and me and the sins of the whole world. They didn't get it. But he said, look at verse 20. Verily, verily, I say unto you that ye shall weep and lament, but the world shall rejoice. And ye shall be sorrowful, but your sorrow shall be turned into joy. Oh yeah, weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. Hey, and he knew exactly. He said, I want to give you this example. I want to illustrate to you the way that you can deal with your sorrow, the way that you can deal with your grief, and how you can turn it over to eternal joy if you'll just listen to what I'm telling you to do. Oh boy, my ears. I've been listening, Lord. I need it, Jesus. I need it. I need you to give me. Tell me what I need. Because my heart's breaking. Anybody like that tonight? Anybody? I mean, listen, going through a little trouble, going through difficulty. Lord, I need to listen. Jesus refers to a woman giving birth. I can't relate to that. He does. Look, a woman when she is in travail hath sorrow, because her hour has come. But as soon as she is delivered of the child, she remembers no more the anguish for joy that a man is born into the world. Ladies, how many of you give birth in here? Let me see your hands right here. Huh? How many of you give natural childbirth? No epidural? Nothing like that? You know, the pain has got to be, the pain is the closest to death a woman will ever be. I mean, the agony that must be going through. But hey, as soon as that child, oh, hey, there's a child. Hey, let me ask you this. Did you remember that pain? No. Because the greatest joy, joy, sorrow gives way to joy. Oh, I remember when Michaela was born. I do. I remember when Michaela was born. And when Melissa was in travail and the blood pressure would drop on that child because the umbilical cord was wrapped around her little throat. And I mean, all these other things, the doctor, there was things that he couldn't see. But hey, when that baby was delivered, I mean, listen, that they laid that little Michaela on Melissa. And she just cried. She said, oh, look, she's beautiful. I said, yeah, she is. And she is beautiful. All that pain's over. Because she's holding her baby. Holding a child. Jesus gives us an illustration of grief and sorrow giving way to joy. Oh, what a day that's going to be. Praise God. Amen. You say, preacher, I'm glad you gave that illustration. I thought you meant somebody in the church was pregnant. God forbid somebody in the church be pregnant. But it's just like that. Giving way to joy, a birth, giving way all the pain, all the grief, giving way to joy. That's what Jesus said right there. He said in verse 22, and ye now therefore have sorrow, but I will see you again. And your sorrow, your grief, your anguish is going to give way to joy forever and forever and forever. There'll be no more pain, no more sorrow, no more sickness, no more sin. Somebody ought to help me out right here now. Jesus is telling them and us what's going to happen. Woo! Man, that's rich. That is. He's explaining them. He's giving an example to them. Just like a woman giving birth. He says, one day, listen, this earth and all its sorrow and all its sadness and all its sickness and all the things that the saints of God are going through, one day it's going to give way to eternal joy. Hallelujah! And we will remember what he said through the power of the Holy Ghost. Well, what do you mean, preacher? Well, I mean, he's giving us all these things. He's saying all these things. He's, you know, the disciples were confused. Jesus gives us clarification. So what is to come? Well, I'm glad you asked. Let's get over here and let's keep reading just a little bit more. Verse 23, and in that day you shall ask me nothing. Watch this. He says, in that day you won't have to ask me anything. What is that? There's a song that is sung sometimes. And I mean, I love that song, Farther Along. Farther along we'll know all about it. Farther along we'll understand why. Cheer up, my brother, live in the sunshine. We'll understand it all by and by. I wonder if we'll even care. I know what the song means, but I wonder if we'll even care. Because he says it's going to give way to joy. It's going to give way. He said, you won't ask me anything. Isn't that what he said? Verily, verily, I say unto you, whatsoever you shall ask the Father in my name, he will give it you. Hitherto have you asked me nothing in my name. Ask and you shall receive, that your joy may be full. Jesus said the Father's going to give you all you need. You're going to have the comfort. In the comforter. So why do we get so distracted and discouraged and confused and need counsel? I mean, hey, listen. He says that the Father will give you all you need through the Son, and the Son will give you the comforter, and you'll have all you need. No short supply. So full. Full of joy, full of peace, full of God. Wow. What are we waiting on? This old flesh. Oh, curse, old flesh. Oh, it's powerful. But you know what your biggest problem is? Me and you. That's our biggest problem. In the mirror every morning, that's your biggest problem. Oh, God, help us. Oh, God, help us to have power in the Holy Ghost. Amen. Let us see your Spirit, God, shining in the most unlikely places throughout our day. Yes, Lord. He said, these things I have spoken unto you in Proverbs, but the time cometh when I shall no more speak unto you in Proverbs, but I shall show you plainly of the Father. No more parables. He said, I'm going to speak to you and you will understand exactly. The Father loves you tonight. Wow. At that day you shall ask in my name, and I say not unto you that I will pray the Father. He said, I'm not going to have to go to the Father for you. You're going to be there. Isn't that amazing? For the Father himself loveth you, because he have loved me and have believed that I came out of God, out from God. I came forth from the Father, and I am coming to the world. Again, I leave you, I leave the world and go to the Father. He said, but one day I'm going to speak to you face to face. It's going to be plain. I'm not going to speak to you in Proverbs. I'm not going to speak to you. Even spiritually, I'm not going to have to speak to you. He said, I will speak plainly to you. Can you imagine what his voice sounds like? Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Sweetest song ever sung, sweetest name on mortal tongue is Jesus. Oh, my. Sweetest name I know. Fills my every longing. Keeps me singing as I go. Oh, my. So, you know, the disciples, they picked up on this real quick, right? Back to reality, Brother Terry. Look at verse 30. Well, let me get 29. His disciples said unto him, lo, now speakest thou plainly and speakest no proverb. We want you to speak plainly to us now. Talk to us now plainly, Jesus. Isn't that what it said? Look at verse 30. Now we are sure that thou knowest all things, and needest not that any man should ask thee, but by this we believe that thou camest forth from God. We want you to talk to us plain now. It seems like you're talking to us in Proverbs now. So the disciples finally say something. Isn't that just like us? Lord, we don't want to have to wait for it. We want you to talk plainly to us now. Because it seems like you're talking in Proverbs to us now. We don't understand all the parables and things that you're saying. But Jesus said, look, I have to go away, and I will send you the Comforter, the Counselor. And then I'm going to be gone for a little while, but then I'll come back physically, and I'll speak to you face to face. That's where the confusion was. That's where the disciples, I mean, aren't we so quick to speak, just like Peter? So quick to talk. Now look, here it is, and this is closing this chapter. Jesus is going to do the talking. And if you hadn't heard any other word in this chapter, you better hear these last words right here. This is why he said everything he said. So, Jesus answered him, do you now believe? He said, are you believing right now? Do you believe I am he right now? Do you believe I'm the Son of God? Do you believe I'm God? Do you believe the Holy Ghost is God? Do you believe the Father sent me so that I got to go away? Do you believe that the Holy Ghost will come? That the presence of God will be in you? Do you believe right now? After you heard all this, look at verse 32. Behold, the hour cometh, yea, is now come, that ye shall be scattered, every man to his own, and shall leave me alone. Wow. Preacher, I thought you said that was good news. Bad news first. He says the time's going to come Oh, when you might even reject my name. When you might even tell people that you don't know who I am. It's going to get so bad. You know, Peter, I'm sure Peter was listening. Peter getting ready to deny him. Jesus said that before that happened. He said, you're going to be scattered. The hour cometh, yea, is now come, that ye shall be scattered, every man to his house, and shall leave me alone. And yet I am not alone because, wow, the Father's with me. Well, what an example Jesus is to us. When everybody turns away from you, he said, let me be your example. He said, you're going to leave me too, but I'm not alone. He said, I'm not alone. The Father's with me. Oh! These things I have spoken to you, that in me you might have peace. In the world you shall have tribulation. Boy, he's laying that bad news out there. You're going to be scattered. You're going to be scared. You're going to be running for your life. You might even admit that you don't even know who I am, just to save yourself physically. Oh, I'm sure that happened, y'all. I'm sure. Listen, hey, people are saved, born again. Hey, listen, they're filled with the Holy Ghost. But when the rubber meets the road and that blade gets ready to cut that head off, I mean, what do you think people's going to do? What do you think? It's got to be real, because we're flesh. I'd never do it, preacher. That's what Peter said too. You know what the devil don't play fair. Unless you say he don't cheat fair either, but let me say this. Hey, all of us that are Christians and that you have children, listen, the devil knows you're not going to quit. But what if they hold your babies up? So you either denounce him, or I'm going to decapitate this child. Watch this now. Jesus says, that's the bad news. We're going to close this chapter. He said, but be of good cheer, because I've overcome the world. No wonder he said, don't let your heart be troubled. In the world, you're going to have tribulation. In the world, you will let me down. In this old flesh, you're going to let me down. Because bad times are coming. But just be filled with the counselor. Remember all the things that I've told you. Remember all the things that I said were going to happen. And no matter what the devil, the flesh, and the world throws at you, be of good cheer, because I've overcome the world. Amen. I've overcome. I've already won. Amen. Stay right there with him. Hey, listen. That's why it's so important that we understand that we should witness to our loved ones. We should witness to our babies. We should, share our faith with them. Let them know that times are coming that are going to be troublesome. I can only share with you the experience of my kids. And let me just say this right quick. I know my wife's already in heaven. I know Melissa's there. I do. If you have your spouse with you, God help you. God bless you. Hey, listen, I would never want anybody to lose their spouse any way, shape, or form. But I'm thankful that I know where she's at. I'm thankful that I believe in my heart that half of me is already there. And listen, I don't know how you look at it, but listen, I've already given my children to God. I said, God, whatever you want to do, whatever happens, they belong to you. And I'm not going to back up on it. Because I know the day we're in. I know where we're living, y'all. I know what Jesus said. I know the Holy Ghost brings all things to your remembrance whatsoever he has said unto you. I know that in this world you're going to have tribulation. I know that you're going to be hated. But be of good cheer. He says, I'm going to leave you for a little while, but I'm going to send you another comforter. Then in a little while, I'm coming back. Amen. And it'll be eternal joy. In your little time of sorrow, thank you, Jesus. Little time of grief that you're going through right now physically. One day it's going to be turned over to eternal joy. What a day that's going to be. That's what he's telling us tonight. Are you listening? Every head bowed, every eye closed, I stand all over the church. Riddell, you play something for us, please. Maybe you just want to pray tonight. Maybe God's touched your heart. Oh. Maybe God's give you a vision. I'm thankful for what he's doing. I pray God fill us with the Holy Ghost. I pray God fill us with the Counselor, the Comforter. You don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. But oh God, I know who holds tomorrow. He's already in my tomorrow. He's already in my future. Do you need to get close to him? He wants you to, I promise you. Without faith, it is impossible to please him. If there's anything we want tonight, is that God would understand, and he knows already how we're living. Heavenly Father, we come to you right now in Jesus' name. God, I thank you for the opportunity just to stand and break the bread of life. Lord, I'm not a prophet. I'm not a foreteller. God, I'm simply a preacher, just foretelling what you've already said. Lord, I pray that your seed find fertile ground tonight. Thank you for every visitor. Thank you for every member that's journeyed out to the house of God. Oh, God, would you have your way in every heart, mind, and soul. God, lead, guide, and direct us. I pray you touch our nation, Lord. Touch the next generation of believers. God, you and you alone only know what lies ahead, but the Holy Ghost is able to be that spirit of truth to stir our hearts that we may heed what we need. And that's the Word of God. Lord, we ask it all in the name, the most precious name that's ever been uttered. Oh, it's in the name of Jesus we pray, for he and he alone is worthy of our praise. And all God's people say, amen. Amen. Thank you for coming tonight. Well, I'm looking forward to Wednesday night. Christ in the Old Testament. Message number two.
In the Bible days, she had lived for so very long, till she heard the Savior was passing that way. So she joined the happy throng. While she was pushing her way through, somebody cried, "What are you trying to do?" She said, "If I..."